Welcome to Center Ice, the Hockey Alberta podcast, home to all things hockey in our great province. Now, here's your host, Ted Emmett.
Hello and welcome to episode 18 of the Center Ice podcast and our final episode of 2021 at that. I am your host, Ted Emmett. Thank you for joining us once again. And it is the holiday season, and in the hockey world, there's one holiday tradition that creates excitement across the country every year, and now in Alberta, particularly this year. So, of course, with the 2022 World Junior Championship about to kick off in Red Deer and Edmonton, this episode is going to have a really heavy World Junior focus with three fantastic interviews lined up for this one. I'm not sure if we've ever had three before, so that's pretty exciting as well. And hey, the day I'm recording this, it's Jersey Day, so you can't really see it, especially if you're just listening online. But I am wearing a Team Alberta jersey for Jersey Day to kind of build the excitement around the World Juniors. So yeah, I'm excited. Hopefully you are as well. First off, we're going to hear from Team Canada forward Ridley Gregg, one of the seven Team Alberta alumni suiting up for Canada at this year's World Junior. So on that note, before we go any further, a huge congratulations to Ridley, as well as Sebastian Kosa, Jake Neighbors, Dylan Gunther, Caden Gooley, Ronan Seeley, and Olin Zellweger, who all have the incredible opportunity to represent their country at the World Juniors in their home province. So it was really cool to get the chance to speak with one of the players about that. Then, to give you a break from hearing my voice, Kevin Strybosch, who is a huge part of the World Junior celebration from both a Hockey Alberta standpoint and as a volunteer, sat down with Riley Wichar, the executive director of the 2022 World Juniors, to give an inside look at what it takes to run an event of this magnitude. And they actually did that live on location. Well, not live, but it was in person on location at the PV Mart Centrum in Red Deer. So that's a pretty cool one. And I was lucky enough to speak with Winnipeg Jets defenseman Josh Morrissey, who played for Canada not once, but twice at the World Juniors, winning a gold medal in 2015, and he had some great memories to share from those experiences. So, with all that said, let's get right to our first interview. All right, so we are lucky enough now to be joined by a current member of Team Canada's World Junior squad. He's a Team Alberta alumni and a first-round draft pick of the Ottawa Senators, so Ridley Gregg, thank you so much for taking the time to do this today.
Yep, thank you. Thanks for having me.
So first off, obviously, congratulations on being named to Team Canada, a huge honor. And I know right now you're really in the midst of getting ready for the tournament when we're recording this interview, just a few days away from pre-competition. Can you take us through the process a little bit from the start of training camp to, I guess, where you are right now, getting ready to get things going?
Yeah, obviously, the first little bit was just getting selected to the camp, which is obviously still a great honor. And then there's two practices, two games, which I didn't play in those. But and then the team was made after that, which when you get the opportunity to play for Team Canada, it's pretty cool. You know, you watch it when you're growing up from Christmas time, New Year's, you're always watching as a kid. So such a great honor to put on the Maple Leaf. So I'm looking forward to it.
And not a bad week for you either, because I know right now you're actually, as you're speaking with us, you're out in Banff doing a little bit of pre-competition, some team training, team bonding. What's that been like so far? I know maybe not as new to you being from Alberta, but probably still a really cool experience to get to take in with the team.
Yeah, it's really cool. Actually, it's good kind of team builder. It's so beautiful here. We went to Lake Louise there yesterday. Which I had never been, surprisingly, but geez, it was unreal. Quite the view from that hotel there. But yeah, it was pretty cool. And you know, you're getting to know the guys and the connections pretty well here. So yeah, it's been fun.
And seven Albertans on the team this year, which is pretty amazing. All seven of you are Team Alberta alumni, and five of you actually played together on the same team at the WHL Cup in 2017. So with this being such a whirlwind process, you know, short-term competition, you have to come together really quickly. How much has it helped you having some people on the team that you have those pre-existing relationships with?
Yeah, for sure. It's awesome. You know, obviously when you go to these camps and you don't know too many guys, you're maybe a little bit shy at first, but I knew these guys pretty well from the years past, either playing against them in Alberta or playing in that tournament or some other tournaments together. yeah, it just makes it so much easier and you're way more comfortable and kind of can be yourself around the room and everything. So yeah, it's pretty nice.
And you already mentioned about the honor of playing for your country. And this year, you know, you get to play in Canada. But not only that, you get to play in your home province. You grew up in Lethbridge, probably lots of family down there being able to come out. What does that mean for you? That's a very rare opportunity to get to play in your home province at the World Juniors.
Unreal. It's unreal. Yeah, obviously to have it in Edmonton, Red Deer, it's quite a short drive for my family, and you know, they've kind of said their congrats to me and everything, and are pretty proud of me. So it's going to be pretty cool for to have them watch me throughout the tournament, which is just unreal to have it here. It's unreal, yeah.
And there's 12 players from the Western Hockey League on the team, including four of your fellow Albertans actually all play together on the Edmonton Oil Kings. Is it a little weird now getting used to calling them your teammates after spending a couple seasons facing off against them? Or is it kind of like an on-off switch when it comes to short-term competition?
Yeah, it's a little bit of both. It's a little bit of an on-off. But, you know, usually you're competing against them and hating on the guy the whole game in the Western Hockey League. But, you know, it's pretty cool to be on the other side of it and to be together facing on the other team, which is nice. Obviously, these guys are such good players here. It's just unreal to play and be on the ice with these guys. But to kind of be on the other side of it and play together for a couple games, it's pretty cool.
And this isn't your first experience with short-term competition or even your first time representing Canada as you played in the Hlinka-Gretzky Cup. But even going back now to the Alberta Cup, playing for Team Alberta at the WHL Cup, how did those experiences when you were a little younger, really just trying to make your way through your hockey career, how did all that help you prepare you for really what's to come at the World Juniors?
Yeah, it helps so much. Through U16 and U17 and U18, kind of learn kind of the process all the way building up to this tournament. I think that's really what it's built for, is just to kind of end it off at this tournament. And, you know, just to have those opportunities and those experiences has helped me quite a bit and should help kind of going into this tournament here.
And a tournament filled with NHL prospects and draft prospects, I think, is one of the reasons why fans love it so much, is it's really a first look at the up-and-coming players in the NHL. You yourself being a former first-round draft pick of the Ottawa Senators, even though you've played a couple of games of professional hockey already in the American Hockey League, do you look at the World Juniors as a big opportunity to show what you can do against really the best of the best and kind of make that next step?
Yeah, I think for sure. Obviously, it's pretty fortunate to be here and to be playing with good players and against them. It's pretty cool just to kind of see what every country is about and other players. But to kind of just play here and, you know, get another notice with the fans and everything, it's kind of just another sort of mindset in your head. I think U.S. With Jake Sanderson there, it's pretty cool to play against him too. I know we've had a couple of battles growing up, but just to play against him, I'm kind of looking forward to it.
And speaking of the fans, I think we all know last year's tournament was really unique in the fact it was completely played in a bubble in Edmonton with no fans. So definitely a different experience for everyone, especially the players. So this year, even though there's the teams still have to bubble and there's a lot of precautions in place, there will be fans. So how excited are you for that to get to play in front of fans?
Yeah, extremely excited. That's kind of been the main kind of topic lately with the guys here talking about the fans. You know, last year with the bubble and everything, how fans can be there, they kind of feel like this year is just going to be kind of explosive and everyone's going to come. So just to play in front of a crowd like that is just going to be unreal. The guys have been talking about it this whole week here, so we're really excited for it.
And not to build on the pressure, but really playing for Team Canada at the World Juniors, there is a lot of pressure. There's a history of winning there again. And even going back to your previous experience, but kind of how are you either dealing with that pressure or embracing the pressure? Or is it kind of for the whole team, not really on your mind and just going in and doing what you do?
Yeah, I think for these first couple of weeks, it hasn't really been on my mind too far. But I'm sure as I get closer to the tournament and the games, the pressure might set on a little bit more, but honestly, I couldn't be more confident in our group here. We got a really good team, and kind of just playing with these guys, I'm really looking forward to it and excited.
And last one for you. You do have the NHL bloodlines. Your dad, Mark, had a lengthy professional hockey career, spent nearly a decade in the National Hockey League, still involved in the game as a scout for the Philadelphia Flyers. So have you leaned on him a lot for advice, not only going into the World Juniors, but really as you've moved through your hockey career?
Yeah, for sure. He's kind of been my main piece, who's kind of developed me throughout these years. And I lean on him quite a bit after games. You know, we chit-chat. I always phone him after the games. Whether he watched it or not, he's always got something to say and just kind of little tips and tricks here and there. So he's definitely been pretty helpful throughout the way and throughout my career.
All right. Well, Ridley, we won't keep you any longer. This, as you mentioned, this is kind of your day off. We really, really appreciate you taking the time to do this interview, though, right in the middle of team training, right before the tournament. I don't think we actually really imagined we'd be able to get a current Team Canada player for this latest podcast episode. So again, we really appreciate it. Thank you for doing this. And of course, all the best to you and Team Canada going into the World Juniors here.
Yeah, awesome. Thank you, guys. Thank you.
And a huge thanks again to Ridley Greig for that. As I mentioned, we weren't sure if we'd be able to land a current player or not for this episode, given the timing. So big thanks to him, as well as Hockey Canada, for helping us line that up. And hey, let's keep things rolling here. So now we're going to go to the PV March Centrium for Kevin Strybosch's sit down with Riley Wichar.
Welcome into the PV March Centrium in Red Deer, which along with Rogers Place in Edmonton, will be one of the host venues for the 2022 IIHF World Junior Hockey Championship, where we are joined by the executive director of the tournament, Riley Wichar. Riley, I know this is a really crazy time for you, so I really appreciate you taking some time to join us today.
Absolutely. Yeah, thanks for having me.
So first off, this is the second year in a row now where the World Juniors are being hosted in Canada, which was not by design. So can you just talk to us a little bit about the process to get to this point?
For sure. Yeah, it definitely wasn't by design. Originally, we were supposed to host the 2021 World Junior Championship in Red Deer and Edmonton. Unfortunately, due to COVID, we had to turn that event into a bubble in one city, one facility. So as a result, last year, we actually hosted it in Edmonton. And then we're able to get the event back again this year to really give fans a chance to see it. Because last year, unfortunately, with no fans, it was a great event, but we wanted people to have a chance to see it live. So through a lot of hard work and a lot of relationships, we were able to get it back this year and look forward to having fans in the stands.
Yeah, perfect. You mentioned the bubble there. I know as Canadians, we view this tournament as kind of a holiday tradition. Usually when we're hosting the tournament, the buildings are packed, the atmosphere is crazy. So what was it like being in the bubble last year with no fans?
It was honestly surreal. To watch a live game with no noise outside of, we had a background soundtrack that, you know, we piped through the TV so you could, it sounded like there was fans there. But it reminded me of watching minor hockey in a way, because there was just, you know, broadcast people, IIHF staff, Hockey Canada staff, and that was it. So definitely a unique experience. One, hopefully we don't have to replicate again, but I'm happy we did it and did it kind of in a safe manner and were able to award gold medals on January 5th.
Yeah. And then looking towards the tournament this year, what does it mean for the tournament to be back in two cities, two host venues with fans in the building?
Oh, it's huge. It's huge. We, you know, one of our biggest regrets was not being able to have this event in Red Deer last year. So to be able to come back here, have fans in the stands, I think it's something that people have been waiting for 3 years since we announced this tournament. And then to be able to do that in Edmonton too, and really showcase that facility and that city, it's just, it's what the World Juniors is all about, having two great host cities. People can travel to both and see their favorite teams and really just kind of showcase Alberta, which is the true intent of what we wanted to do originally.
What can we expect from some of the international teams that are coming?
I mean, for one, the pool in Red Deer is unbelievable. You know, you got the US, which is the defending champions here. You're going to get to see Sweden. You're going to get to see Russia. So the competition's unbelievable. You know, Canada is obviously the favorite, but I think every team has a legitimate chance to win. And then the beauty of the World Juniors is, you know, communities adopt a team usually. So in Vancouver, in Victoria, it was Kazakhstan that was kind of the underdog, and the, you know, the the city of Victoria kind of took them under their wing and cheered them on. Denmark back in 2015 in Toronto was kind of the same thing. So, you know, I think the Germanys, the Austrias of the world, they're going to maybe win some games and surprise a few people. So to me, it's the best hockey there is. And I think, you know, coming out to see any of the games is just an absolute thrill for people.
And with any major event like this, the hockey is obviously the main draw, but there's also lots of stuff happening outside of just what's happening on the ice. So can you just give us some information on what's going to be happening around Edmonton and Red Deer away from the games?
Yeah, that's the other neat part about this event is that even if you don't have a chance to attend in person or have a ticket to the game, we want people to be involved. So, you know, in Red Deer, right next door to the arena, we're hosting the Ice Barn, which is our fan fest. There's going to be giant screens. All the games are going to be on TV. People can come have something to eat, something to drink. We've got 7 concerts through SiriusXM that we're doing. So, and it's free. So, you know, people in Red Deer have a chance to come out and check out the event without, you know, watching a game if they don't want to. And then in Edmonton, the plaza right out front of Rogers Place, they're going to animate that. So there's going to be, the games on the big screens. They're going to be fan giveaways, some activations. So, you know, similar to Red Deer, really a cool spot for people to come hang out and check things out. And then, you know, the other cool thing this year, we're doing the World Junior Virtual Experience. So if you're not here in person or you're not in Alberta, you can buy a ticket and check out our 3D environment where people can interact with other fans, play games, check out stats, and actually watch a live show every day, which is something we're trying this year. So we're trying to find ways people can get involved. And, you know, at the end of the day, we just want to share this with as many people as possible.
That's awesome. My last one here for you is how can fans purchase tickets or get involved? And is there anything else that you want to just share about the tournament coming up?
Yeah, tickets are on sale now. So all single games are available. HockeyCanada.ca is where you can find ticket information. And they're reasonably priced. I mean, you can get in the building for pretty cheap. So we're encouraging people to buy whatever they can and come support all the countries. And really just, you know, thanks to all our partners. You know, you guys at Hockey Alberta have been fantastic leading our trophy tour throughout the province and supporting on the volunteer side. And we're just really excited to get going. Where it's been a long time and to have fans back is going to be great. So yeah, thanks to the City of Red Deer and City of Edmonton for their support too.
So one neat feature this year that was part of kind of the lead up into the tournament was the World Junior Trophy Tour. Where communities were able to bid or apply to host the World Junior Trophy in their community leading into the event to kind of create some excitement. They were given tickets and swag to hand out and basically created a hockey event for one weekend leading into the tournament. Do you want to just touch on that and how that created an exciting atmosphere for communities that might not be near Edmonton or Red Deer, but create a whole buzz around the entire province?
Yeah, I mean, it was a great idea that came together with partnership with you guys at Hockey Alberta. Our goal, again, is always to try and expand the reach of the tournament. And this was one of the ways that we could do that. So, you know, going to different communities with the trophy, showcasing that, seeing kids have a chance to play for the trophy, and, you know, just get the community involved. It's probably the first time a lot of these communities have been able to do anything for the last 2 years as a community. So this was kind of that catalyst to bring minor hockey back and to really showcase the event throughout the province. You know, we went to places like Frog Lake and Canmore. You know, we're back in Edmonton and Red Deer to finish it up next weekend. And just being able to go on the road with that trophy, it's going to be a very cool memory for a lot of people. So we're thankful for what you guys did to put that together. And, you know, it's just another nice legacy piece that we're able to showcase as part of this whole World Juniors.
Yeah, I was lucky enough to be able to go to most of these trophy tour events. And I have to say that all of them just, they completely knocked it out of the park. I think they completely gathered the spirit of what we were trying to go for. So they They had ball hockey tournaments, regular ice hockey tournaments. They did feature games around some of their junior teams and different things like that. One of the communities didn't even have their ice in, but they just created an off-ice festival, all celebrating the World Juniors, celebrating hockey, and celebrating having the trophy in their community. So for me personally, to be able to go to these communities and see how appreciative and how excited they were to get this trophy and get this opportunity, it was really awesome for me to see as well. So
I would add to that and say, like, the people you're probably able to meet on that tour, and just to be back in touch with those minor hockey associations. And, you know, I got a few comments from, you know, even groups that I believe one community had a parade where they put a float in for the World Juniors as part of that. So, you know, I think it's amazing. The fact that you're able to go to those communities too is such a fantastic thing. So thanks for doing that.
Yeah, no problem. That was White Court. They incorporated the trophy. They built a float and put the trophy on their parade float for their Santa Claus parade at the beginning of December. So that one was awesome. It was a little chilly that day in White Court, but we made it through. So it was awesome. So once again, I just want to say thank you for taking some time to chat with us today. Your life sounds like it's pretty wild right now. So once again, thank you and good luck with everything with the tournament this year.
Anytime. Appreciate it. Thanks.
Thanks again to Kevin and Riley for that one. Lots of great information on the upcoming World Junior Championship, or I guess depending on when you listen to it, it could be the past World Junior Championship. But either way, a great interview, a really cool inside look there on what it takes to run that tournament. And always nice to get to do those in-person interviews on location as well. So before we get to our third and final guest, as always, it's time to take a look at what's going on around the province. So here's what you need to know. Lots of buzz around the province as Hockey Alberta has announced the host communities for the 2022 Provincial Championships presented by ATB Financial. For obvious reasons, it's been a couple of years since we last had provincials in Alberta, so very exciting to announce the hosts of the 29 championships that will happen in March and April. For a full list of those host communities, head to haprovincials.ca. And after going all virtual last year, Female Hockey Day returns to the ice in 2022 as Lloydminster will be the host on Saturday, January 29th. The event encourages female players, parents, coaches, and supporters of all ages to gather for the development, growth, and celebration of the female game. Communities around the province are encouraged to take part in the celebration as well and host their own Female Hockey Day events, with the Hockey Alberta Foundation actually offering a $1,000 every kid, every community grant for up to 10 associations who do want to host an event. The deadline to apply for a grant is December 31st. You can head to hockeyalberta.ca for more information on that. And a huge congratulations to the 73 Albertans who are registered in Hockey Canada or Hockey Alberta sanctioned programming who were selected at the 2021 Western Hockey League draft back on December 9th. Defenseman Charlie Ellick was the first Albertan off the board as he was selected third overall by the Brandon Wheat Kings, with three more recent Team Albertans, Merrick Howell, Tristan Doyle, and Captain Caleb Hadland, also going in the first round. For the full list of Albertans drafted, head to hockeyalberta.ca. And that's what you need to know. As always, for more information on any of the aforementioned subjects, head to hockeyalberta.ca. With us now is a Calgary product who's gone from Springbank Minor Hockey to a steady presence on the Winnipeg Jets blue line in the NHL after they selected him 13th overall in 2013. He was part of Team Alberta's bronze medal squad at the 2011 Canada Winter Games and has represented Canada on 7 occasions, which includes gold medals at the 2012 IIHF World U18 Championship and Ivan Hlinka Memorial Tournament. And of course, he suited up twice for Canada at the World Junior Championships in 2014 and 2015, winning gold in 2015, while also being named to the World Junior First All-Star team. So Josh Morrissey, thank you so much for taking the time to join us.
Hey, thank you very much for having me.
First off, as we're now well into the holiday season, we get to this time of year, there's always lots of buzz in the hockey world as we get closer to the World Juniors. So as a full-time NHLer now, is it still something you and your teammates look forward to every year? And really, do you get reminiscent of it at this time of year as well for your World Junior days?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, it's such a special tournament. And obviously, as you mentioned, you know, having had the you know, honor of playing in the tournament twice, you know, winning a gold medal. I mean, it's something I look back on with such fond memories, you know, on so many levels, for me as a, you know, Canadian, you know, memories of, you know, watching, you know, the tournament with my grandparents, my parents, my dad, you know, on Boxing Day and throughout the holidays. And, you know, from, I don't know, even the time I was maybe 5 or 6 years old. I mean, as long as I can remember, you know, the holidays, I can remember watching the World Juniors. So, it's always been a part of my, career and my sort of life and dream of, you know, eventually playing in the tournament and, to actually, you know, have been able to achieve that. And, on two occasions and, you know, certainly the second occasion playing in Canada, in front of, you know, our home country fans, you know, there's really nothing else like it. It's such a special tournament at that age in your career. And, yeah, my teammates and I, we still, you know, have friendly banter about it, whether it's, you know, fellow Canadians, guys that have played in it, you know, different years, some guys younger and older, maybe they couldn't get the job done, or, you know, I guess fortunately for me, I kind of, you know, have the bragging rights that I was able to, you know, our year was able to get it done and get the gold. And then of course, amongst other countries, you know, I think on our team, we've, you know, got the American guys, the Russian guys, Finnish guys, you know, I don't know if we have any Swedes right now, Danish guys. So, I mean, you know, it's always on in the room, highlights and whatnot. And, you know, certainly, a little bit of, you know, friendly banter here and there when our countries are playing one another. So yeah, it's just such a great tournament and, you know, during a great time of the year.
So you answered a whole bunch of my questions there in one answer. So you've obviously done this before, but with the World Juniors being hosted in Canada every second year, as you mentioned, you had the opportunity to play in Toronto and Montreal in 2015. You also played in Sweden overseas in 2014, but this year now there's 7 Albertans on the team who not only get to play in Canada, but also get to play in Alberta in their home province. So, and you already touched on what it means to you, what it meant to you to be able to play in Canada. What do you think it means to those players to get to play now in their home province as well, which is a pretty rare thing?
Yeah, no, I apologize for answering a bunch of questions there. As you can tell, it's something I get pretty excited about, talking about the World Juniors and, you know, my experience at the tournament and whatnot. So, you know, it's definitely not your standard hockey, you know, 2-sentence answer that you get in between periods for me. But yeah, you know what? It's I can only imagine how special it is for those guys. I mean, you know, as you mentioned, my first go round was in Sweden, and you know, it was a totally different experience. Obviously, you're away from home, you know, for much of sort of December, and we were in Europe for a few weeks prior to the tournament even beginning. So, you know, it's still awesome. You get to spend a lot of time with your teammates and whatnot, but you're away from home. And, although we did have a pretty heavy, Canadian, fan presence come over and watch us, and support us, obviously you're not on home soil. So, you know, it's a little bit different. And then, you know, the next year being in Canada, Toronto, Montreal, it is just that much more, you know, crazy. And, you know, it was insane. I mean, looking back at some of the footage of the fans, you know, at our games and how loud it was, the intensity and excitement, you know, it's just another level. So again, I couldn't even imagine what that would be like to, you know, be able to, as a player, do that not only in Canada, but in your home province. And, you know, as an Albertan, it's nice to see that, you know, hockey in Alberta is producing, you know, that many great players that are, you know, basically among the best in Canada, and to have 7, you know, representing, you know, Canada and Alberta and the minor hockey associations that they came from within the province. That's pretty special. And again, to have the tournament in Alberta, even it's the cherry on top. So it's good to see that, you know, what we're doing in the province for hockey is producing high-end players.
And all seven of those players, just like yourself too, are Team Alberta alumni. Five of them actually played together at a WHL Cup, and two also played together at the 2019 Canada Winter Games, which I think is it's a really great brag for Alberta. I don't think you see that too often. And you had some Alberta ties on the team both years when you played as well. You were also able to suit up with former Canada Winter Games teammates Eric Comrie and Dylan Hetherington. You had some other Team Alberta alumni from other years on the team as well, and a few fellow Winnipeg draft picks and WHL teammates. So how did having all of those kind of pre-existing relationships really help you and your teammates come together in a really short period of time? Because you do have to build those relationships very quickly when it comes to short-term competition.
Yeah, no doubt. I mean, I think, you know, sort of through all of those events, I think, you know, really the first one being the Alberta Cup, you know, way back sort of at the end of my second year at Bantam, just before the Bantam draft, and you sort of start going, you know, through the Hockey Alberta summer camps. And you know, obviously then, as you mentioned, you know, U16, you know, U17 with Team Pacific, which with a bunch of the guys from Alberta, U18s, and everything's kind of working towards World Juniors, which is obviously for good reason, the goal of, I feel, you know, all the kids going through the system, sort of under the Hockey Canada and Hockey Alberta umbrella. You know, the World Juniors in amateur, amateur hockey is like, you know, I feel it's the biggest event, until you turn pro. It's, you know, one of the few tournaments where, you know, obviously you get that caliber of player and players that are, you know, some maybe in the NHL or on the cusp of being NHL stars, playing, all together. So I think it's sort of the culmination of that sort of, those years of playing in on those teams and in those tournaments. I mean, yeah, as you mentioned, Eric Comrie, I think we played together, you know, U16, 17, 18 World Juniors. We've played together in the minors, with the Manitoba Moose, and then, now we're together again here with the Winnipeg Jets and NHL. And we actually went to a World Championships with Canada a number of years back as well. So, you know, it's pretty cool when you can kind of, you know, experience those tournaments and make friendships. For example, I'm getting married next summer, and he's one of my groomsmen, and I wouldn't have known him throughout, you know, if it wasn't for that process. So, it's pretty cool the connections you can make. And as you said, I think once you get to the World Juniors, it's basically a month from the time you arrive at the training camp until, you know, the gold medal game. And the better you can know everybody from past experience, I think, puts you ahead of the competition in forming that sort of team bond.
Yeah, you know, we always say how small the hockey world is, and that's a really cool example of just that. And on that note too, you kind of alluded to the fact, you know, that the World Juniors are a great opportunity for those young prospects who are looking to make the NHL, or even in the case of some players, like a guy you played with, I think his name's Connor McDavid. He was your teammate both years, actually, and in his case, it was his chance to really show why he was such a highly touted draft prospect. But for yourself, you know, how did those 2 years at the World Juniors, now you've been drafted by Winnipeg, you have a chance to show your stuff, how did that help prepare you to make the jump to professional hockey?
Yeah, I mean, I think for me it was an opportunity to play against the best competition sort of your age at any of those tournaments, and certainly on a big stage when it comes to the World Juniors. Up until that point in time, you know, I had played some pro experience the year prior in the AHL with the St. John's Ice Caps, and we had a pretty good playoff run. But you know, I never really had played in front of, you know, a 20,000 fan arena with, you know, everybody going crazy. And, you know, I played some NHL preseason games, but obviously, you know, preseason, there's nothing on the line compared to talking about trying to win a gold medal. So I think just that experience of, you know, playing under, you know, a lot of pressure and you know, basically having to, you know, find a way to prepare and bring your best stuff. And it's a short-term competition. So, you know, there's no time to, you know, I guess sort of go into a slump or have a few bad games. If you have an off shift or, you know, you don't like a mistake that you make. You know, I think one of the biggest things is learning how to turn the page and move on and, you know, don't let it sort of turn into two mistakes or two bad shifts, because, you know, there just simply isn't time for that in a tournament like that. So lots of things like that. I mean, you mentioned Connor McDavid. You know, another, I think, great part of those tournaments is being able to play with, you know, guys of that caliber. I was able to play with him, you know, at three tournaments and, you know, kind of become friends, make a cool friendship with him, and just see how, you know, talented he is, what he could do with the puck. I mean, you know, you can't help but learn when you're out there with guys like that. And, you know, the other super talented players that I was able to play with at those tournaments. So, you know, I think it's, you know, there's so many things you can learn from, improve on in your game. And when you're out there with the best, it only makes you better. So I look back with, you know, as I said, I gained a lot of experience and knowledge and, you know, improved a ton at my World Junior experiences.
Yeah, I can only imagine as a defenseman, you'd much rather play with Connor McDavid or players like that than against him. I also can't imagine the pressure of playing for Team Canada at the World Juniors and a huge history of success there. And, you know, sorry to bring up the past a bit, but going back to 2014, when things really didn't go Canada's way, you lost 2-1 in the bronze medal game, just narrowly missed out on the podium. You lost to Russia. But then the next year, with a handful of returning players, including yourself, you did exact your revenge on Russia in the finals to win gold. So how did that adversity from 2014 help you and the other returning players come back the next year, knowing really what it would take to go all the way and win gold?
Yeah, I mean, it was tough. You know, as you said, it was, you know, the expectation as a Canadian and rightfully so is, you know, win gold or anything less is really, you know, a disappointment. And obviously, you know, there's things that are out of your control. And, you know, sometimes you have to give credit to the other great hockey countries out there that, you know, are producing obviously great players as well. But at the same time, that's, you know, the expectation in Canada, you know, at those big events to win. So, it was disappointing. It was tough. Certainly, you know, we kind of spoke, with the returning players a number of times, you know, in that sort of year in between, at the summer, camp and, at various occasions. And I think, there was a real sort of sense of unfinished business amongst us. And I think, you know, obviously Hockey Canada put together a pretty talented roster, and we just went in with a ton of confidence. We played, you know, loose and you know, just with a lot of energy and excitement. We didn't try to, you know, worry about mistakes. We just, you know, don't think, just go and be on your toes and play as fast as you can. The message from the coaches, I think, from day one was, you know, let's play at a higher pace than we've ever played at individually before on our, you know, junior college teams. And let's just go after it and see, you know, kind of what level of execution we can play at. And, you know, I think it pushed us. I think it helped me improve as a player. And I think it got the most out of our guys. And, you know, we ended up having a pretty phenomenal tournament. you know, went through some adversity in the gold medal game. I think we were up 4-5-1, and you know, Russia kind of scored, I think, two or three quick ones on us. So all of a sudden, going in the third, it was 5-4, and the building was a little bit quiet, and the dressing room was a little bit quiet. But our coaches came in and kind of kept things light, and we went out there and really shut it down in the third, and found a way to get it done. So, you know, I think it almost was not more meaningful, but I think, you know, we were, you know, I'm proud of the fact that, you know, we went through that adversity and in a, you know, basically under the spotlight of, you know, the country. And we came out and just got back to focus and play our game in the third and you know, held it together. So that was pretty cool. And certainly, you know, singing the anthem and wearing the gold medal, you know, standing on the blue line, something I'll never forget.
And so that obviously is a great memory for you and Canadians in general. And anyone who follows the World Juniors remembers that game. We remember every gold medal game. So that moment aside, this might be a bit of a hard question to answer, because you can hear the excitement hear the excitement in your voice when you talk about World Juniors. But do you have any moment, whether it's a specific moment or just something about the World Juniors, that stands out in your mind as a favorite memory?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, there was a lot of different ones. I think just probably when the final buzzer went and we knew we, you know, won the gold. As I said, the third period was pretty, you know, we were defending a lot of it and trying to, you know, maintain that one goal lead. And I think if memory serves, they had a face-off in our end, sort of with a few seconds left, and it was a bit of a scramble. And just finally, when the, you know, buzzer went and we knew we won, it was just, you know, the culmination of so much work. And I think, you know, I don't want to say relief, but there was just this feeling of, you know, we did it. And anyone that's won a championship knows sort of what that feeling is like. It's really unmatched. You know, because it's something that you accomplish with, you know, your teammates, you know, the sacrifices you had to make, missing, you know, Christmas and a number of things, and, you know, or whatever, you know, all of that kind of stuff. It just kind of comes to you know, a point there. And so I would say then, you know, I had a couple nice individual plays, some goals, and, you know, scored on New Year's Eve against the U.S., which was pretty cool. And but I'd say just, yeah, winning the gold was, and that moment when the buzzer went was something pretty darn special.
Wow. And I could, as a hockey fan, could sit here and talk about World Juniors with you for hours, and we will wrap up here to let you go. So last one for you, as we go back now to your Alberta roots, you came up playing minor hockey in Calgary, played your elite hockey there as well, suiting up for the Calgary Royals, went through the Team Alberta program, played Alberta Cup, played for Team Alberta. Then you went to Prince Albert and Kelowna to play in the Western Hockey League. But right from your minor hockey days to playing for Team Alberta, and even now still, how much do those Alberta roots mean to you?
Yeah, I mean, it means everything to me. You know, it's, you know, where I'm from, it's where I grew up. It's still where I call home in the off seasons in Calgary. You know, from the days out at, you know, out in Springbank at the Springbank Arena, you know, it's where I started playing the game. It's where I had my first practice, you know, and sort of, you know, outdoor rink, falling in love with the game as a kid. And, you know, spending so much time out there, you know, with my family, with my dad, you know, all through the years, onto the Royals. I mean, same thing, just, you know, so many great friends and friendships and memories on the ice, off the ice. And it's just, Alberta's a special place to me. It's, like I said, it's where I'm from, and it's, you know, I'm proud to be from Alberta. I'm proud to be from Calgary. And, you know, again, playing for Team Alberta, you know, a lot of those similar emotions that I would have felt, you know, on a national level playing for Canada. You know, I felt, you know, the pride of being from Alberta and representing our province. So, you know, it's always a treat to go back there in the off season and go home and be with family and friends. And, you know, I certainly wouldn't, you know, be where I'm at in my career without, you know, my, I guess, the starting points and large part of my, you know, I guess, improvement in my career in Alberta and in Calgary. So very, very fond memories. And, you know, it's where it all started for me.
Oh, and that's a perfect note to end on, because we will let you go. As I mentioned, I could talk to you for hours about all this stuff, but we really do appreciate you taking the time to do this interview and share some of your World Junior memories with us. I think it's always a privilege to get to hear those firsthand from players. And you did it not only on an off day for you, but during an incredibly busy time of year. So thank you so much for doing this. Best of luck to you and the Jets the rest of the season. And of course, happy holidays.
Hey, thank you very much for having me. Always a pleasure to, you know, reminisce on those times. It makes me remember and keep those memories fresh as well. So looking forward to tuning into the World Juniors this year and seeing Canada, you know, chase the goal and hopefully get another one.
All right. Thanks again, Josh. Appreciate it.
Awesome. Happy holidays. Thank you.
A huge thank you again to Josh Morrissey for taking the time to do that interview, especially while he was out and about on an off day, had lots of stuff to do, and still managed to take the time to call in for that one. So really appreciate it, because he's obviously someone who's very passionate about his time at the World Juniors. So it was really cool to get to hear some of those memories. And that's it. That's all for episode 18 of Center Ice, and really for 2021 in general. Thanks again to Ridley Gregg, Riley Wichar, and Josh Morrissey, as well as Kevin Strybosch for the interviews. Again, a really great episode, a great way to tee up the World Juniors and build some excitement there. And on that note, a thank you to all of our incredible guests in 2021, and a huge thank you to producer Steve for all the work he puts in behind the scenes to get these episodes out, usually on a pretty tight turnaround. But the biggest thank you of all goes to you for listening. It is an absolute pleasure to host this podcast and highlight the people from around the province who make our game what it is. So I can't wait for another year of Center Ice in 2022. So on behalf of everyone at Hockey Alberta, I'm Ted Emmett. Thanks for listening. Have a safe and happy holiday season. Happy New Year, and all the best in 2022.
Thank you for listening to the Center Ice Podcast. For this episode and more, head to hockeyalberta.ca. If there's a topic you'd like covered on an upcoming episode, email info@hockeyalberta.ca.